This is the young woman I jotted down last night, and she's no use to me. I have all the records I want of the Listen Grove lingo. I'm not going to waste another cylinder on it. Oh, be off with you. We don't want you here.
Don't you be so saucy. You ain't heard what I come for yet. Did you tell him I come in a taxi?
Nonsense, girl. What do you think a gentleman like Miss Higgins cares what you came in?
Oh, we are proud. Well, I ain't here to ask for any compliment. I've come to have lessons, I have. And if my money's not good enough for him, I can go elsewhere.
Good enough for what?
Good enough for you. Now you know, don't you? I've come to have lessons, I have, and to pay for them too, make no mistake.
So what do you expect me to say?
If you was a gentleman, you might ask me to sit down.
Huh. Pickering, will we ask this baggage to sit down, or will we just throw her out a window?
Oh, ow! I won't be called baggage or I'm to pay like any lady.
But what is it that you want?
I want to be a lady in a flower shop instead of selling flowers at the corner of Tottenham Court Road. But they won't type me unless I can speak more genteel. He said he could teach me. Well, here I am, ready to pay, not asking any favours, and he treats me as if I was dirt. Now I know what lessons cost, and I'm ready to pay.
How much?
Now you're talking. I thought you'd come off it a bit when you saw a chance of getting back a bit what you chucked at me last night.
Sit down.
You'd had a drop in, hadn't you?
Sit down.
Excuse me. What is your name?
Eliza Doolittle.
Won't you sit down, Miss Doolittle?
I don't mind if I do.
Now, how much do you propose to pay me for these lessons?
Now you're talking. I know what's right. A lady friend of mine gets French lessons for 18 pence an hour from a real French gentleman. Now, you wouldn't have the face to ask me the same for my own language as you would for French. So I won't give you more than a shilling. Take it or leave it.
You know, Pickering, if you consider a shilling, not as a simple shilling, but as a percentage of this girl's income, well, it works out to 60 or 70 pounds from a millionaire. By George, it's the best offer I've ever gotten.
Oh, 60 pounds? I don't have 60 pounds. Where am I going to get 60 pounds?
Oh, hold your tongue.
Oh, I've never even had 60 pounds.
Oh, sit down, you silly girl. Don't cry. Nobody's going to touch your money.
Someone is going to touch you with a broomstick if you don't stop snivelling. Now sit down.
One would think you was my father.
If I choose to teach you, I'll be worse than two fathers to you. Now here.
What's this for?
To wipe your eyes. To wipe any part of your face that feels moist. Remember, Eliza, that this is your handkerchief and this is your sleeve. And don't go mistaking the one for the other if you want to become a lady in a florist shop.
I say, Higgins, what was it about your boast that you could pass the girl off as a duchess at the embassy ball? I'll bet you're the greatest teacher alive if you can make good of that. I'll bet you all the expenses of the experiment you can't do it. And I'll even pay for the lessons.
Oh, you're real good. Thank you, Captain.
It's almost irresistible. She's so deliciously low, so horribly dirty.
Ah, I ain't dirty. I washed my hands and face before I came or did.
I'll take it. I'll make a duchess of this draggle-tailed gutter snipe.
How?
I'll start right this moment, today. Take her away, Mrs. Pierce, and wash her off. Sandpaper, if it won't come off any other way. And is there a good fire going in the kitchen?
Yes, but...
Wonderful. Take off all of her clothes and burn them. Bring up for some new ones and just wrap her in brown paper until they come.
You're no gentleman. You're not to talk of such things. I'm a good girl, I am, and I know what the likes of you are, I do.
We want none of your slug prudery here, young lady. If you want to become a duchess or a lady in a florist shop, you'd better start acting like it. Take her away, Mrs. Pierce, and if she gives you any trouble, just wallop her.
I'll call the police, I will.
Oh, but I've no place to put her.
Just put her in the dustbin.
Come, Higgins, do be reasonable.
Really, sir, you must be reasonable. Really, you must. You can't walk over everybody like this.
I walk over anybody? Oh, my dear Mrs. Pierce, my dear Pickering. Oh, I never had the slightest intention of walking over anybody. I simply suggest that we should be kind to this poor girl. And if I did not express myself clearly, it was because I didn't want to hurt her delicacy. Or yours.
But, sir, you can't pick up a girl like that as if you were picking up a pebble on the beach.
Well, why not?
Well, why not? Well, you don't know anything about her. What about her parents? She may be married.
God.
There's the girl very properly said.
says, "Yeah."
Who would marry me?
Oh, by George, Eliza, I'll have men shooting themselves in the street for your sake before I'm through with you.
Oh, here he's off his chumpy is. I've had enough of this. I won't have any balmies teaching me. I'm going.
Oh, mad am I? Well, then, you needn't worry about the clothing, Mrs. Pierce. Just throw her out.
Oh, stop, Mr. Higgins. I won't allow it. Go home to your parents, girl.
I ain't got no parents.
There you go. She ain't got no parents. So, what's all the fuss about? She doesn't belong to anybody, and she's of no use to anybody but me. Now just take her away.
But what's to become of her? Is she to be paid anything? Oh, do be sensible, sir.
Ha! Paid anything? What will she do with money? She'll only drink if you give her money.
Oh, it's a lot! You are a brute! Nobody ever saw the sign of liquor on me! Oh, sir, you're a gentleman! Don't let him speak to me like that!
Does it occur to you, Higgins, that the girl has some feelings? No. No, none that we need worry about, have you, Eliza?
Mr. Higgins, I must know on what terms the girl is to be here. What is to become of her after you've finished your teaching? You must look ahead a little, sir.
What's to become of her if I leave her in the gutter? Answer me that, Mrs. Pierce.
That's her own business, not yours,
well,
Mr. Higgins.
Well, once I'm through, we'll throw her back into the gutter, and it'll be her own business again. So that's all right.
How, you no heart, you ain't never had enough of this. I'm going.
Oh, Eliza, wait, have a chocolate.
A
pledge of good faith. Here, I'll eat one, and you eat the other. Yes, you shall have boxes of them, barrels of them every day. You shall live on them, eh?
I wouldn't have eaten it, only I'm too polite to take it out of my mouth.
Think of it, Eliza. Think of chocolates and rides and taxis and gold and diamonds.
I don't want no gold and no diamonds. I'm a good girl, I am.
I'm sorry, Higgins, but I really must interfere. If the girl is to stay here for an experiment for 6 months in teaching, she must understand thoroughly what she's doing. All right, then. Eliza, you're to stay here for the next 6 months, learning how to speak beautifully, like a woman in a florist shop. If you're good and you do everything you're told, oh, you'll have a proper bedroom, lots to eat, and even some money to go off and buy chocolates, take rides and taxis. If you're naughty and idle, you shall sleep in the back kitchen among the black beetles and be walloped by Mrs. Pierce with a broomstick. At the end of 6 months, you'll be taken to Buckingham Palace, beautifully dressed in a carriage. Oh, if you're discovered, you'll be taken by the police to the Tower of London, where your head will be cut off as a warning to other presumptuous flower girls. If you're not discovered, you'll have a present of 7 and 6 to start a new life as a woman in a shop. If you refuse this offer, you'll be the most ungrateful, wicked girl, and the angels will weep for you. Are you satisfied now, Vickery? Could I put it more plainly or fairly, Mrs. Pierce?
Eliza.
Yes, that's right. Bundle her off to the bathroom.
Oh, you're a great boy.